शुरू कर दो।
Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to our largest online medical and dental classroom, Axis Dental School. I would like to greet everyone a lovely Tuesday evening. COVID-19 is here to stay, but my medical student life feels less lived every day. Our online offline classes and the lectures are sprinkled in. I look PPE for protecting my heart. Yeah. COVID-19 is harming all of our lives, but for medical students the most. And we have a lots of queries about our studies. But my dears, why you are so worried? Cheers, because we have a very friendly Axis Dental School who is working to improve the academic and co-curricular academic and co-curricular skills of medical and dental students and the doctors across the country. Career, it's also works about the career seminar, so on. And today we are coming to a awaited program, prepare presentation program, episode 7. And today our topic is periodontal packet. In this whole program, I will be your moderator, Nisha Tamimahe, Northeast Medical College, Session 2019 and 20. And now it's an honor for me to welcome our judges of this episode. And first of all, I would like to welcome our brilliant and respected foreigner judges, Dr. Ankita K. Kotecha, ma'am, MDS, periodontics, gold medalist, dental studies simplifies. Our another honorable judge is Dr. Ansaruddin Ahmed, sir, BDS, FCPS, Assistant Professor and Head Department of Periodontology and Oral Pathology, Chattogram International Dental College. And finally, our very own mentor and our very favorite judge, Dr. Anupam Poddar, sir, Associate Professor and Head Department of Periodontology, Oral Pathology, Dhaka Dental College. I welcome all the respected judges that you have here to share your knowledge and vast experience with us. And now I would like to introduce our talented participants of tonight, and they are Bibi Khadija Anushapu, City Dental College, Session 2016-17, Farha Tabasumapu, Holy Family Red Crescent Medical College, Dental Unit, Session 2016-17. And our last participants is Fariha Chaudhuri Didita Apu, Sir Solimullah Medical College, Dental Unit, Session 2016-17. We're so excited to have all the three participants to in our seventh episode. And to begin this program, I want to share with you that we have a rule in this program, discussion session. And after discussion session, we have a very interesting things will be held, and that is our very talented and very excellent presenter, foreigner judge, Dr. Ankita K. Kotecha ma'am's presentation. So, my dear viewers, I hope you all will be there to achieve the vast knowledge from the presentation of our very honorable Dr. Ankita Kotecha ma'am. So to begin this program, we are pleased to have our foreigner judge, Dr. Ankita K. Kotecha ma'am, to deliver some advice for our participants. Please.
Good evening, doctors. I am Dr. Ankita Kotecha, and I am here to judge you mainly for your knowledge. Rest everything is optional for me particularly. So I wish all the students bring out the best of the content in the best of the manner possible. Okay. My good wishes to all of you. Do your best. Give your best shot. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, are you hearing me?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yes, let's begin with the presentation now.
Yeah, ma'am. And now I would like to request Dr. Ansaruddin Ahmed, sir, to share your point of view. Sir, please.
Assalamu alaikum. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, assalamu alaikum. Welcome everyone in tonight's episode of paper presentation competition. I'm very much honored to be here as a judge of this session. For my students, I just want to say that this is not an exam. Okay, so you don't need to be scared or you don't need to feel any tension. Just be relaxed, be chill, and give your full effort to your presentation. And I hope you all do. You all will do a very good presentation. So that's all. I think we can proceed. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for your valuable remark. And finally, I would like to request our very own mentor, Dr. Anupam Poddar, sir, to deliver some advice for our participants.
A very good evening. Thanks to today's moderator, Nishat Tamrin Mahin, and North East Medical College, Dental Unit. First of all, I would like to thank all the organizers and event management team of Accidental School, who is organizing such like very nice academic program. I hope it will be helpful to our student who will get chance in large forum in to participate. Today's group name Neighbors, and today's topic is periodontal pocket. Participants of Neighbor groups are Bibi Khadija Anisha from City Dental College and Faria Tabassum from Holy Family Christian Medical College Dental Unit and Faria Chaudhary Ridita, Sir Solomon Allah Medical College Dental Unit, all the under the session of 2016 and 2017. I am wishing their brilliant success. I am also thanks today's foreign judge, Dr. Ankita Kotecha, who bear gold medal in MDS course. He is very intellectual lecturer. After ending the session, she will give lecture on same topics. She discuss any topics in simplified form, which is easily understandable. I hope everybody enjoy her session. I request all my beloved students, please be here her session. I hope it will be very much helpful to you. And another judge, Dr. Ansaruddin Ahmed, is assistant professor, Chittagong International Medical College, Chittagong International Dental College. Thanks to all. And I have a suggestion to my beloved student. During presentation, you follow this point. First of all, we evaluate you by topic discussion, slide preparation, explanation with diagram, inclusion of evidence-based data study, understanding of the subject, response to question and answer, and reference use, and dressing change, and presentation skill, and maintenance of time. So time is very sensitive. Every judge give 100 marks to all participants, and 10% marks from social media, love care like this. That is previously declared in social media. Thank you. I hope you will be do better job, and thanks to all.
Thank you, sir, for talking of your appreciation. I know that all of you are so excited about this episode, and I'm also super excited for this episode. So I'm sure that I will take only some time to read out the whole rules of this episode. So the rules are, each participants have 10 minutes for their presentation. After 8 minutes, I will notify them. Then within 2 minutes, the participants have to complete their presentation. After presentation, there will be a question and discussion session with our judges and the participants. And that's all about our role. And now I'm starting the main portion of our program. And now I would like to Bibi Khadija Anushapu to share your presentation with our judges and the viewers.
Thank you so much, Nishata Sima and Tapu. Hello everyone, Assalamu alaikum and adab. Myself, Bibi Khadija Anusha from City Dental College. I would like to thank Axis Dental School platform for giving me such a great opportunity. And I also thank for my honorable teachers and doctors. Now let's get started. Here is my bio. Myself, Bibi Khadija Anusha from City Dental College. My session is 2016 and 2017. My batch is CD22. Here is some pictures of my college. Today, my topic is periodontal pocket. Here I am describe the definition of periodontal pocket and the types of periodontal pockets. Periodontal pocket, here are some definitions. According to Cowson's, periodontal pocket depends on the thickness of the gingival tissues when plaque extends along the tooth surface and the overlying gingiva is thin, the gingiva is lost protruding recession. According to Carranza, periodontal pocket can be defined as pathologically dependent of the gingival sulcus. According to Shanti Priya Reddy, pocket can be defined as depending on the gingival sulcus. Here are some classifications of pocket, gingival pocket and periodontal pocket. Periodontal pockets are simple pocket, compound pocket and complex pocket. Another are supraboni pocket and intraboni pocket. Intraboni pockets are one wall osseous defect, two wall osseous defect, and three wall osseous defect. Here are some pictures of pockets. There are simple pockets, these are complex pockets, these are compound pockets, these are gingival pockets, and supraboni pockets and intraboni pockets. Depending upon the number of surface involving, simple pockets involving only one tooth surface. We have compound pockets involving two or more tooth surfaces. Complex pockets, where the base of the pocket is not in direct communication with the gingival margin, is also known as spiral pocket. Another classifications are supraboni pocket and intraboni pocket. Supraboni pockets, the bottom of the pocket is coronal to the underlying alveolar bone. And the intraboni pockets are the bottom of the pocket is apical to the level of the adjacent alveolar bone. Here are some pictures of supraboni pocket and intraboni pockets. There are some reference from different books and different writers. These are Essential of Oral Pathology and Oral Medicine by Cowson, Clinical Periodontology by Carranza and Newman, Essential of Clinical Periodontology and Periodontitis by Shanti Priya Reddy. Thank you so much all for you have your patience. Now I hand over the presentation to the next presenter. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Apu, for your brilliant presentation. And now I would like to our next presenter, Farha Tabassum Apu, to share your presentation with our judges and the viewers.
Thank you, moderator. Assalamualaikum everyone. I'm Farah Tabassum from Holy Family Redcliffe Medical College Dental Unit, session 2016-17. Currently, I'm a final year BDS student. This is my college, Holy Family Redcliffe Medical College. It was established in 1953. The college section started its journey in the year of 2000, and the dental unit started its journey in the year of 2011. As you all know, my topic was periodontal pocket, and here is my contents. Clinical features of periodontal pocket, pathogenesis of pocket formation, and histopathology of pocket. Clinical features of periodontal pocket. Clinical feature is consists of signs and symptoms. Symptoms are what will patient present to me and what will he feel. Localized pain or sensation of pressure in the gingiva after eating, which gradually diminishes. A foul taste in the localized areas. A tendency to suck materials. Radiating pain deep in the bone, a gnawing feeling or itching in the gum, the arc to dig a pointed instrument in the gum, and relief is obtained from the resultant bleeding. Patient complains about sticking of food between the teeth, sensitivity to the to cold and heat are present, and there is toothache present in absence of caries. These are the symptoms I already mentioned in the diagram, so I won't be explaining them again. These are the signs. Means what will the patient? What will we see when we examine the patient? We will see enlarged bluish red marginal gingiva with a rolled edge separated from tooth surface, a bluish discoloration area extending from the gingival margin to the alveolar margin. The mobility extrusion and midline diastema, marginal migration of diastema, shiny discolored and puffy gingiva associated with exposed root surface and bleeding, purulent exuded from gingival margin. These are the infos I explained earlier. Now, pathogenesis of pocket formation. As you all can see, this is a healthy gingiva, and this is a gingiva that already has developed periodontal pocket. Now we will discuss about how this healthy gingiva has turned into this situation. In the picture, you all can see plaque has been already accumulated here. Here we can see the plaque has been extended into the gingival sulcus. And on the third picture here, gingival sulcus has been detached, and the apical migration of the junctional epithelium has occurred. On this picture, here we can see neutrophils have arrived and induced phagocytic action. This picture, we can see the action has caused ulceration of the pocket epithelium, and finally, the pocket has formed and there is bone loss. This is the flowchart of the pathogenesis. In the first event, changes occur in the junctional epithelium spread along the root surface in finger-like projection. In second finger-like projection, coronal portion detaches from the root and the apical portion migrates into the junctional epithelium. On the second event, gram-negative bacteria growth, immigration of the neutrophils, disruption of the bacteria, loss of hemostatic gradient, and tissue destruction due to products released by neutrophil and bacteria. Now, and then pocket is established. Histopathology of periodontal pocket. It means what will we see under the microscope? What will be the changes in the soft tissue wall if we see under microscope? The changes are exudative and degenerative. The blood vessels are engorged, dilated, and edematous connective tissue. Presence of plasma cells, lymphocytes, and polymorphonuclear cells. Healthy epithelial cells are present, and there is degree of degeneration. Pocket contents. Here, the pocket contents. Pocket will contain debris containing microorganisms and their product, dental plaque, gingival fluid, food remnants, salivary mucin, the squamated epithelial cell and lymphocyte. If purulent exudate is present, it consists of living, regenerated, and necrotic leukocyte, living and dead bacteria, and scanty amount of fibrin. Pus can also be present, but as a sign of secondary infection. Periodontal pocket as a healing lesion. Here, constructive and destructive change both occurs at a time. That means there is continuous effect of repairing and degeneration of tissue. Complete healing does not occur. As the bacteria keeps attacking, on the figure we can see the inner half is ulcerated and outer half is collagenous. Microtopography of gingival wall of the pocket. Here we can see leukocytes present on the surface of the gingiva, and there is scanted bacteria. This causes ulceration and bleeding. The changes in root surface wall. There are mainly three type of changes occurs in the root surface: structural, chemical, and cytotoxic. During cytotoxic change, cementum is increased. In chemical changes, there is increase in cementum. On cytotoxic changes, cementum is covered by calculus where all the changes take place. Attached plaque covers the cementum. Zone of unattached plaques, zone where junctional epithelium is attached to the tooth, and apical to the junctional epithelium, there is a zone of connective tissue. Periodontal disease activity. There is activity, periods of activity and periods of inactivity. In periods of activity, attachments are lost as pocket bleeding while probing and pus is present. In period of inactivity, reduced inflammation, no loss of bone and tissue. So that was all about my presentation. I mainly took reference from Carranza, but I also took reference from Shantibia Reddy's ma'am's book and Carranza South Asia edition. Thank you everyone for being patient. Thank you Anupam Poddar sir, thank you Ankita ma'am, thank you Ansaruddin sir and our moderator, and my special thanks to Exist Dental School for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you so much Apo for your an amazing presentation. Now I would like to request our final participants, Fariha Chaudhuri Didi Tapu, to share your presentation.
Thank you, Nisha. My dear respected judges, my dear fellow mates, and all the audiences out there, Assalamu alaikum and a very good evening. Myself, Fariha Chaudhuri Ridita from Sir Solimullah Medical College Dental Unit, Session 2016 and 17, is standing here as the third presenter of the group Neighbor. So presentation topic of today's night is periodontal pocket. Before starting my presentation, I would like to thank Dr. Anupam Poddar sir, Dr. Ankita Kotecha ma'am, and Dr. Ansaruddin Ahmed sir for their valuable presence among us amidst of their busy schedules. In my part of presentation, I will focus mainly on what does a pocket contain, diagnosis of pockets, probing techniques, and conclusion. Without any further delay, I am starting my presentation. In analyzing the contents of pocket, we get debris consisting microorganisms and their products like enzymes, endotoxins, and their metabolic products, gingival fluids, food remnants, and salivary mucin, desquamated epithelial cells and leukocytes, occasionally purulent exudate that consists of living, degenerated, and necrotic leukocytes, living and dead bacteria, serum, and a scanty amount of fibrin. Let's come to the diagnosis of pocket. The most common procedure we follow in diagnosis is careful and gentle probing of the sulcus, probing with a periodontal probe is the simplest, most widely used and preferred method of identifying pockets. There are also some unpopular methods, such as injecting radioopaque dyes into the sulcus may give us a fair idea about the extent of the sulcus area, but this may not always give correct measurement. And also perioscopy. Perioscope can be used to visualize the sulcus or pocket. As it requires special training and expensive equipment, this method is not very popular. Injecting radioopaque dyes and using periscope. Both of these are technique sensitive and also time consuming and also expensive too. So comparing advantage disadvantage ratio, mostly we use probing in diagnosis of a periodontal pocket. As measured by a periodontal probe, depth of a clinically normal gingival sulcus is formed 1 to 3 mm, while the depth of a pocket will be greater than 3 mm. To clinically differentiate between the sulcus and pockets while probing, we need to consider the attachment of junctional epithelium with cemento-enamel junction. In the first illustration, we can see here the junctional epithelium is located slightly above the cemento-enamel junction. The junctional epithelium attaches along its entire length to the enamel cone. This scenario we get in healthy gingival sulcus. In the second illustration, we can see coronalmost portion of the junctional epithelium detaches from the tooth, resulting in an increased probing depth that will denote a gingival pocket. In this scenario, the depth of the gingival pocket increase not because of any pathology, but due to gingival hyperplasia. So this is not considered as true pocket. And as we can guess, a false illustration of increased pocket depth, it is also denoted as pseudo pocket. And in the third illustration, we can see increased pocket depth is due to apical migration of the junctional epithelium. Junctional epithelium forms the base of the pocket by attaching the root surface somewhere apical to cemento-enamel junction. This is the scenario we get in periodontal or true pocket. Now come to the probing principle. During probing, we follow some principles for effective measurement of probing depth. The first one is only one reading per area is recorded. If the probing depths vary within an area, the deepest recording obtained in that area is recorded. In this illustration, we can see probing depth between A, B, and C points is considerably different. As the C is the deepest, we will record the reading of the point C for this facial surface. Next, probing depths are recorded to the nearest full millimeter. Measurements are rounded up to the next higher whole number. For example, a reading of 3.5 mm is recorded as 4 mm. Adaptation. Once a probe is inserted into a periodontal pocket, working end is kept parallel and in contact to root surface. By comparing these two illustrations, we can easily understand what is the correct way to periodontal probe insertion and adaptation, and which is the incorrect. This is the most important principle in periodontal probing. Working stroke is the movement of calibrated probe around the perimeter of base or pocket. The probe is inserted until the tip encounters resistance of junctional epithelium. Working stroke is created by moving the probe up and down in short bobbin strokes and forward in 1 mm increments. The probe is not removed from the sulcus or periodontal pocket with each upward stroke. The pressure exerted with the probe tip against the junctional epithelium should be between 10 and 20 grams. Either wrist or digital activation is used with the probe, as very light pressure is required while probing. Here is a study on probe tip diameter conducted by Dr. Garnick and Lee Silverstein. They conducted this study to determine the importance of the diameter of periodontal probing tips in diagnosis and evaluating periodontal disease. In the study's review, the pressure used to place the probe tip at the base of the periodontal sulcus or pocket was approximately 50 newton per centimeter square, and at the base of the junctional epithelium, 200 newton per centimeter square. A tip diameter of 0.6 millimeter was needed to reach the base of the pocket. In conclusions, they claim probe tips need to have a diameter of 0.6 millimeter and a 20 gram force to obtain a pressure which demonstrate approximate probing depth. The pressure was needed to measure the reduction of clinical probing depth. During probing depth measurement, we measure the distance from the gingival margin and the base of the sulcus or pocket with a calibrated periodontal probe. During probing, we record six specific sites on each tooth. Distofacial surface, from distofacial line angle to the midline of the distal surface, facial surface, and mesofacial line angle to midline of the distal surface, which is mesiofacial surface. And in the same manner, there are also three points in the lingual surface also: distolingual line angle to the midline of the distal surface, lingual surface, and mesolingual line angle to the midline of the mesial surface. At starting probing in any tooth, we insert the probe on the distofacial line angle, and after that we walk toward the midline of the distal surface with our periodontal probe. Upon contacting with the opposite contact area, we slightly tilt the probe and access beneath the contact area. Gently press downward to touch the junctional epithelium. As the distofacial surface is done, for assessing facial surface, the probe is repositioned as the distofacial line angle moving in a forward direction toward the mesofacial line angle. Finally, reposition of the instrument and work toward from the mesofacial line angle to the midline of the mesial surface until the probe touches the contact area. Here, in the same manner, we tilt the probe and extend beneath the contact area. As the facial aspect is done, we will do probing the all three area of lingual aspect in the same manner. In conclusion, I want to say, following all principles and advent of newer modified instruments will ensure more error-free pocket depth measurement and accurate diagnosis of periodontal disease. Here are all the references I have taken to prepare this presentation. Before ending my presentation, I would like to thank Axis Dental School for arranging such a prestigious event and give us the opportunity to be in touch with all the legendary professors of home and abroad. Thank you to everyone. I have already ended my presentation. Thank you, everyone. Sorry, I can't hear anyone.
Sorry, I was muted, sorry. Thank you so much, Apu, for your presentation. It was an amazing presentation. And all of our participants have an amazing presentation. And I think, I hope that our judges will like it a lot. And now I would like to request our honorable judges to discuss about the presentations and let us know about any question that you have for the participants. So I would like to start with Dr. Ansaruddin Ahmed, sir. Sir, please.
Thank you, moderator, for giving me the opportunity to ask a few questions. As I said earlier, this is not an exam, so I'm not gonna make you fail. So don't get tense. I will just ask very basic questions to our participants. Our first presenter, I'd like to ask her. She was talking about the different types of our classification of periodontal pocket. So I'd like to ask her, what is the difference between true pocket and a false pocket? Can you distinguish between these two type of pocket?
Sorry, sir.
Am I clear? Can you get me? Hello?
Sir, can you repeat the question?
Sure. Okay, you talked about classification of periodontal pocket. So I'd like to ask you, what are the difference between true pocket and false pocket?
Sir, true pocket and false pocket.
Just tell me the difference between these two types of pocket.
False or pseudo pockets হচ্ছে coronal movement of the gingival margin without the destruction of the underlying periodontal tissue is designed as pseudo pocket, whereas apical migration of the junctional epithelium with the destruction of supporting periodontal tissue is designed as a true pocket.
Okay, thank you. So can you give me an example where we can find a pseudo pocket? Can you give me an example of any condition?
Examples.
Any gingival condition that may create a false pocket?
Sir.
Some noise over there. Khadija,
yes, sir.
Can you hear me? Can you?
Yes, sir. I can hear you. Sir, I can't. Sorry.
Okay, thank you. No problem. Okay, I would like to move to the second presenter. You described the pathogenesis of periodontal pocket formation. So, and we know during the pocket formation, there are destructions of connective tissue, there are destruction of the soft tissue. So how the collagen destructions occur during the pocket formation?
Sir, collagen destruction occurs due to endotoxin and enzymes and other products secreted by bacteria and inflammatory cells.
Okay, can you name the enzyme that can destroy the connective tissue of collagen fibers?
Sir, I can remember.
Okay.
Potatoes or something like
this. I would like to ask you a very very simple question. What are the microorganisms that are found in the periodontal pocket?
Sir, actinomycetum comitans, Prevotella intermedia, and other gram-negative bacteria.
Can you tell me the difference of microorganism found in gingivitis and periodontal pocket or periodontitis? What are the different microorganisms?
Sir, in case of periodontitis, there is gram-negative bacteria, and in case of gingivitis, there is gram-positive.
Thank you. For the last presenter, you have shown how to diagnose periodontal pocket and how to do the probing. So I'd like to ask you, how will you place, in which manner you will place the periodontal probe into the tooth to determine the pocket depth? What is the direction of the periodontal probe?
Sir, it will be parallel to the tooth and in contact, parallel to the root surface, and short bobbin strokes in 1 millimeter increment.
Okay. And can you tell me the type of different probing depth? Can you explain? different type of clothing.
Probing depth from 1 to 3 millimeter is normal gingival sulcus. Greater than that is we call pocket.
Okay, I think that's all for my part, and I would like to thanks all the participants for the brilliant presentation. And I hope we all enjoyed the presentation. So the moderator, you can take over the microphone from me. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. I hope our presenters and viewers will learn a lot from your discussion. And now I would like to Dr. Ankita K. Kotecha, ma'am. Can you please share your point of view and your questions with our presenters?
Thank you. Thank you, moderator. And thank you, Axis Dental School, for this session. The presenters as well as the presentations, everything is going wonderful as of now. So I'll start with the first presenter, that is Khadija, right?
If I'm yes, not ma'am.
Yeah.
Maybe Khadija.
Yes. So for you, I have one question. Under classification of periodontal pockets, can you give example of gingival pocket? A case scenario where you find only gingival pockets.
Gingival pocket. Ma'am, gingival pocket is also as pseudo pocket. These pockets pseudo are found pocket. In gingival hyperplasia.
One periodontal disease or one periodontal condition characterized by... Sorry, that's a procedure.
Sorry.
That's the treatment of gingival pockets. Tell me one periodontal disease under that huge lengthy classification, Gary C. Armitage, 1999. And there is a long list of classification of periodontal diseases. Out of that, tell me one condition which is characterized by purely and only gingival pockets. Never mind.
Sorry, ma'am, I can't.
Never mind. Read about it then later on. Yeah. Another question for you is, when you classify periodontal pockets as supra-bony and intra-bony, what are the other terminologies for the same? Other names for the same. Other names for supra-bony pocket, other names for intra-bony pocket. There is a lot of confusion about terminologies around this. If you can clarify it.
Okay. Supra-bony pocket and intra-bony pocket. Vertical.
That's the pattern of bone loss. I want the other names for supra-bony pocket and other terminologies or alternative names for intra-bony pockets.
No. Ma'am, supra alveolar pocket is the supra bony pocket.
Supra
alveolar
opposite.
And the same intra alveolar pocket is called intra bony pocket.
Also, intra bony pocket is also known as infra bony pocket.
Infra bony pocket.
That's the major and the most common confusion amongst the students. What is the difference between intra-bony and infra-bony? Both relates or both means the same. Okay, one last question for you. How do you describe the relationship of bone with the pocket depth? I mean, in case of supra-bony pocket, what is the status of the base of the pocket and the what is the relationship status of base of the pocket and the crest of the alveolar bone?
and what is the relationship status or the positional status of base of the pocket and crest of the alveolar bone in case of intrabony pocket? Where does the pocket wall lie? What is the position or location of the pocket wall in case of suprabony pocket and intrabony pocket? What is the difference? That's the major difference between these two types of pocket.
Base of the pocket to the gingival margin.
That's dorsal pocket depth.
Yes.
No problem. Can do better. Okay. Excellent as of now. I expect better presentation next time. Yes, sir.
Ankita madam, yes, please sir. Give the answer of all of question.
Yes, ma'am.
After completing
the session. If they don't answer, I will complete it or cover it in my session. Don't worry. I will give the answers to the same. But I expect a better presentation next onwards. Okay. Good luck.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you too. For the next presenter, Farha Tabassum.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Good presentation. Well done. My question is, how do you discuss site specificity in case of a periodontal pocket?
Ma'am, I didn't understand the question. Site specificity.
There is a terminology called site specificity when it comes to discussion of the histopathological and microbiological aspect of a periodontal pocket. This is one very common viva as well as short question. Site specificity. If you can answer it.
Ma'am, some portion on histological slides, some portions are ulcerated and distracted and some portions are collagenous. And is it what you mean? Sorry, ma'am, then I don't know.
No problem. And how do you discuss probing depth versus loss of attachment?
Okay. So normal pocket depth is 1.3 millimeter and probing depth is 2 millimeter. But when it is deepened, 2 to 3 millimeter, but when it is deepened, it crosses 3 millimeter, we will say that a periodontal pocket has been formed. Ma'am, if we find a pocket depth more than 3 millimeter, we will say pocket is present.
Thank you. And for the third presenter, Pariha Chaudhary Ridita.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening. Good presentation. For your session, I want to know, you discussed the diagnosis of probe and you concluded your session with hoping that there will be more better instrumentation or instrument protocols or instruments available so that there are error-free readings, right? So do you know the various generations of periodontal probes?
Ma'am, there are three generations, first generation, second generation, third generation.
Three. So first generation is conventional probes, our hand instruments, right? What is the second generation?
Ma'am.
Second generation probes?
Sorry, ma'am. Ma'am. Second generation? Ma'am, I don't have actually clear idea about the second generation briefly.
And to correct your answer, there are five generations of probes.
Sorry, ma'am.
If given a chance in future, I will take a separate session on this topic.
We would like to have a ma'am. We would like.
I'll cover this probe itself is a vast topic. I will given if given a chance by Axis Dental School and my co-judges, sir. I will take this as a separate session for you all.
Of course.
We would like to have a session with you.
But one common question to all of you, all three of you, why have you not referred 13th edition of Carranza?
Ma'am, actually, 13th edition is not available in the PDF.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. I was checking out your references. Nobody gave reference of 13th edition of Carranza.
Ma'am, I gave 13th edition of Carranza and South Asian edition of Carranza.
Third edition of South Asian. I was looking for 13th edition Carranza, and one more thing was missing from all three's presentation is a presentation should end with a brief summary of what all you discussed, because you people are discussing the matter for a continuous of 8 to 10 minutes. So always keep in mind 7 to 8 minutes should be your actual presentation, and the last 2 minutes, because after 8 minutes the moderator will give you a alarm, right? Alarm ringing that you have only 2 minutes to left over, right? So the last 2 minutes should always be reserved for brief summary of your topic, so that even we get a brief brush up of the matter that you have discussed till now. Okay.
That's
so far, nice. I think.
Ankita madam always do this.
Yes. So these two are my must and should included things. Summary, index, and the latest terminologies and references. So far, good presentation. I expect a lot more. Hopefully, if I see you people in the next session. Okay. Thank you once again, everyone. Good luck for the next session. Over to you, moderator.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for your questions and your advices for our presenters, and I think our presenters has learned a lot from your questions and your advices, and not only our participants, also our viewers has learned a lot, and it's a very honor for us that you are here and giving us advice of your busy schedules. It's a pleasure for us. And now I would like to our very own mentor, Dr. Anupam Poddar sir, if you have the questions of our participants, sir, you can discuss about the questions.
Thank you, today's moderator, for your nice moderation. And I also thanks to all presenters of today's session. Really fantastic presentation. All are well done. And I have some question, and only one question for each presenter. And I hope our foreign judge, Dr. Ankita Kotecha, give the correct answer after the completion of the session. Then first of all, I would like to one question from to Khadija Anusha. What do you mean by combined pocket?
Yes, sir.
What do you mean by combined pocket? Okay, thank you, no issue. Now I'm going to the Faria Tabassum. Yeah, Faria Tabassum. Faria Tabassum, I would like to ask question to you. What are the instrument, periodontal instrument, periodontal probe? What are the periodontal probe used for the measurement of periodontal pocket? And which is better? What are the types of periodontal probe used for measurement of periodontal probe, periodontal pocket, and which is better?
Sir, I only know one instrument, periodontal probe, and it is used. Sir, I don't know about any other.
Okay. Then now going to the Faria Chaudhary Ridita. And when plastic probe and metallic, when plastic probe is used?
Sir,
plastic probe is used when the patient is affected with any communicable disease when we use disposable instruments? In that case, we use a plastic probe.
Okay, thank you. I may refer the answer to my foreign judge, Ankita Kotada. And please, Dr. Ankita, you may give the answer all of the in you after your presentation or
during. I'll
now,
cover it during my
paper?
Presentation.
After your presentation.
I'll cover it during my presentation.
Okay. Okay. Thank right? you. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Dr. Nishad, you may go to the madam presentation. And
yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for your question. And now we have a very amazing part of this episode that we have the presentations of Dr. Ankita K. Kotecha ma'am. And I hope you will learn a lot from this presentation. It's a very honor for us that ma'am is sharing his presentation with us. So please, stay tuned with us and look our ma'am's presentation. Ma'am, can you please share your presentation?
Yeah, just give me a couple of minutes to
ma'am.
Adjust my camera, right? So the board is visible to all of you?
Yes, visible. But sound is not clear, ma'am.
Wait, let me try. Fair enough now?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Clear to all of you? Am I visible?
Yes, visible.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So first of all, in periodontal pocket, I will discuss the few classifications briefly. The first classification is gingival pocket and periodontal pocket. And there is the first thing to remember is the healthy sulcus. Okay. There is no coronal migration of the gingival margin, no apical migration of the junctional epithelium. Okay, a healthy gingival sulcus, the range is up to 3 mm, less than or equal to 3 mm. Okay, this 3 mm also because normal toothbrush bristles reaches only up to 3 mm. Clear? Coming to pocket, when it is pocket, there are two pockets. Gingival pocket and periodontal pocket. Gingival pocket is also known as pseudo pocket. Why pseudo? Because the definition of pocket is apical migration of the junctional epithelium, deepening of the sulcus due to apical migration of the junctional epithelium. There is the destruction of the periodontal tissues and that is why there will be apical migration of this base of the pocket. Okay. So this is true pocket because it is true to the definition of the pocket. Okay. Then we have gingival or pseudo pocket. Here it means it is a pocket, but it's not true to the definition because here there is no deepening of the sulcus due to the apical migration of the gingival sulcus or junctional epithelium. The deepening of the sulcus is due to coronal migration of the free gingival margin. Clear? So So this coronal migration is due to the enlargement of the gingiva. There is increased bulk of the gingival tissue. For example, as per my question, here the example will be gingival enlargement. Again, there will be many various types of gingival enlargement, but the one enlargement which has only pseudopocket is drug-induced gingival overgrowth in absence of any other periodontal disease. Okay. So this is the first answer as per my question. And then the question asked by our sir, combined pockets. Combined pockets are, let's say in this case, if I modify this diagram, is the diagram visible clearly?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So in this diagram, if you can judge it from this CEJ, the half portion of the sulcus depth or pocket depth is due to apical migration of the junctional epithelium, and the half portion, it's not a mandatory rule that it should be 50-50, but some portion of the sulcus is contributed by apical migration of the junctional epithelium and some portion is contributed by coronal migration of the sulcus. Here, this case scenario where there is both coronal migration of the sulcus, coronal migration of the gingival margin and apical migration of the junctional epithelium, both are present altogether contributing to this gingival sulcus deepening is called combined pocket. Clear? Is the concept of combined pocket clear to all of you? Okay. The pocket type where there is both coronal migration of the pre-gingival margin and apical migration of the junctional epithelium, both are present, both contributing to the final pocket depth, is called combined pocket depth. Clear? So some portion is pseudo, some portion is true pocket. So true and pseudo both present, that is why combination, and that is why the name combined pocket. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, if we talk about the periodontal pocket, which is a true pocket, true because it involves periodontal tissue destruction. Okay. So periodontal tissue destruction is involved here. Talking about the bone status, as per my question, the relationship of the bone. So let's take this scenario, and then if we take this scenario once again, this is the bone level here. So under periodontal pocket, we have supraboni and infraboni. The other names, as per my question, supraboni is also known as supraalveolar and supracrestal. So don't get confused. Supraboni, supracrestal, supraalveolar is the same. Talking about intraboni, intra, T, and infraboni, F. Both are same. Subcrestal and intraalveolar. Four names for intraboni pocket. So all four are same thing. So no confusion. What is the difference between intrabony pocket, infrabony pocket? It's one and the same. Okay? But the main difference between intrabony pocket and suprabony pocket, that is the relationship between the bone and the pocket wall. Here, if you see, this portion is the pocket wall. Okay? This is the wall of the pocket. Clear? So here, this pocket wall lies between bone and tooth. Is it clear to you? This wall,
yes, ma'am.
Darkening it, this pocket wall is between the bone and tooth. Clear? This is the relationship between bone and the pocket wall in case of intrabony pocket. The base of the pocket is below the crest of the alveolar. This is the level of the crest of the alveolar bone, and this is the base of the pocket. So see, the base of the pocket, base is below the crest of alveolar bone. Got it? And so ultimately, the pocket wall lies between the tooth surface and the bone. Clear? And that is why when we probe these intrabony pockets and probe it laterally, a lateral pressure, we will find a hard resistance because of this bony component. Similarly, in case of supraboni pocket, the base of this pocket, first of all, the wall is above the bone. This is the bone here. The wall
pocket wall is above the bone. Here it is below. Okay, or in between. Here it is in between and here it is above. First difference. Second difference, the base of the pocket is above the crest of the alveolar bone. Clear? Here it is below. This is the second difference. Clear? And that is why when we probe supraconic pockets, we will not find that hard resistance by this bone. We will only find soft resistance because entirely of the soft tissue wall. Clear? And then there is one more classification based on the surfaces involved. Simple, compound and complex. Complex is also called as spiral. Simple means one surface, compound means two or more surfaces, and spiral. Spiral is a very particular pocket which is involved with furcation. Spiral means somewhere in the posterior, it begins from this furcation area, involves this surface, let's say this is buccal, and then it turns around and twists and involves other surface. Let's say this is mesial. So twisting around, spiraling around the tooth, that is why the name spiral pocket. Clear? I hope the terminologies associated with the classification of periodontal pocket is now clear. True and pseudo, that is gingival and periodontal. Suprabony and infrabony, the various names of them. Simple, compound and spiral. Clear? Anything else in this classification that you want me to discuss? We also discussed combined pockets, which has both the components pseudo and true. Okay. Now we will discuss two main concepts. That is periodontal pocket as a healing lesion. As the second presenter discussed, periodontal pocket as a healing lesion. Okay. And the one of my questions, site specificity. So we will discuss those two questions also. We will discuss this while we discuss the clinical features and correlate it with the histopathology. So remember, periodontology is more clinical field associated with lots of histopathology, right? So that is why as the clinician, when we are looking into perio case, we should know the clinical features and also understand or have a thorough knowledge of the underlying mechanisms, the histopathology involved or present in that site. So, as per the presenter, they discussed the clinical features. There are mainly five as per me. As per Karanza 13th edition, I'm giving my reference, 13th edition Karanza. Please try to get 13th edition and refer it. It's a really wonderful book. So, the first feature is red and blue discoloration. That is, you must have red, bluish red discoloration, right? So that is because of stagnation, the circulatory stagnation. Okay, the vasoconstriction and the circulatory stagnation, this contributes to the bluish red discoloration. The second point is bleeding. The bleeding is because of increased vascularity. The third point is pain. Somebody discussed gnawing pain and urge to dig in. That pain is because of this ulcerated wall. The wall we just discussed, it is in between the bone and tooth, or it is above the bone. Mm-hmm. Ulceration of that pocket wall leads to pain very quickly. And increased vascularity leads to bleeding. The second last point is exudation. This is not a mandatory point. This is observed sometimes, it's not always. Okay, so exudation is in case the inflammation is suppurative in nature. Suppuration. Okay, so the last and the very important point, as we discussed, it is bluish red discoloration. Sometimes it will be pink and firm also. Okay, see, when it is bluish red, the walls will be smooth and shiny because of the loss of the epithelium structure. And it will be edematous also. Pitting on pressure due to the edema. Okay. So now it is clear. We have two components. Edematous and fibrotic. And then we have the answer. When will it be pink and firm? When the fibrotic component will be more than edematous. Okay. So now here comes the concept of periodontal pocket as healing lesion. Okay. As the presenter discussed, the periodontal pockets are constantly undergoing repair. Clear? So why are they not able to achieve 100% repair? Because of the constant attack from the bacteria, viruses, and other microorganisms involved in periodontal pathology. Okay, and that is why there is always a competition between the inflammatory component and the repair component, the constructive component and the destructive component. These two components are always in a competition. So if the destructive component is greater, then we have this bluish red discoloration, smooth shiny surface, and pitting on pressure, flaccidity of the tissues. Okay, but if the fibrotic, that is the repair component, wins or is ahead of the inflammatory component, then we have firm, pink and firm tissue. But again, this is a pseudo presentation, because from outside we will see it as pink and firm. But if we see that inner pocket wall, this pocket wall, this will be very ulcerated. The outer wall will look, this outer wall will look pink and firm from outside. But the actual matter will be really very diseased. Clear? So this is the fifth presentation and the underlying histopathology. The question that I asked, site specificity. Site specificity, again, I'll tell you one thing beforehand. Do not confuse it with microbial specificity. There is another concept, microbial specificity, in the chapter microbiology of the periodontal disease. Okay? This is site specificity. Site specificity means, let me ask you, have you ever seen a case with the full mouth generalized periodontal pockets on all the surfaces of all the teeth and of the same depth? No. The pocket depth varies from tooth to tooth, and even on the six points that we discussed, mesolingual, midlingual, distolingual, and same on the buccal. Okay. There are six points of opening. The pocket depth is visible on all the six points also. So site specificity means the pocket depth does not begin, the pocket disease activity does not begin on all the tooth or all the surfaces at the same time. There is variation. Okay, there is some specificity that the pocket depth will deepen on certain teeth, and even on certain teeth, certain surfaces or the points. Okay, it will not be same or constant overall. Okay, this concept is called site specificity. So this is about the periodontal pocket and the pocket depth. The various classifications, once again, gingival or pseudo, periodontal or true, and the combination of the two. And under periodontal or true pocket, we have supraboni and intraboni, the various alternative names for the same. And another classification based on the number of surfaces involved, simple, compound, and complex, that is spiral. And these are the five main clinical features. There are many, but these are the five main features to be remembered with their histopathology undergoing. That is bluish red discoloration, bleeding on probing, pain, suppuration, that is exudation, and sometimes very less, but pink and firm wall. Clear? And the two main concepts, site specificity and periodontal pocket as a healing lesion. Okay? If you have any other questions with you that you want me to discuss, you may go ahead.
Go ahead. Please go ahead, madam.
Please, ma'am, go ahead.
Okay, so I'll continue with probing depth versus CAL, that is the loss of attachment, clinical attachment level or loss. Okay. I already have one separate video on my YouTube channel, Dental Studies Simplified. There is a video by name Probing Depth versus CAL. The L stands for loss or level. Oh, okay. I've already discussed that in detail. I will discuss it once again here in brief. So we have something called as probing depth and CAL. This L stands for level or loss. It's still a confusion. So the answer here is, it's a level when it is a single time measurement. That is, you measure it before the procedure or after the procedure. So we say the clinical attachment level was, let's say, 6 mm before the procedure, and after the regenerative or the flap surgery, the level is now 4 mm. But when you call it lost, it means it is the difference of the two points measurements. Okay, earlier it was 6, now it is 4. So the loss is minus 2. Or in other words, you can say gain. Gain is plus 2. From 6 mm, we have now achieved 4 mm post-therapy. So it is a gain of plus 2, or if you want to use the term loss, it is minus 2. Or even if there is an actual loss, let's say there is an actual loss of 3 mm. Okay. If there is a loss, let's say it was 6 mm before, now it became 9 mm. So there is a loss of plus 3 mm. So this is one confusion that is prevalent amongst the students and practitioners sometimes. When to use level, when to use loss. So this is the answer. Level is a single point measurement terminology. That is, either you use it pre-treatment or post-treatment. And loss is the difference between the two entities or measurement state. Clear till now? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, the next question that I want to solve is, out of the two, which entity is a better indicator or representative of the disease activity? Okay. So, is the probing depth better denoter of the disease activity or loss of attachment? Okay. So, here the answer is, the loss of attachment is a better denoter or indicator or representative of the disease activity. Why? If you read the chapter, Periodontal Pocket from Carranza 13th edition, you will get a very clear answer. See, there are three case scenarios. Here, these are the three case scenarios. A normal sulcus, a pocket, and here is the recession. Okay, the pocket depth is variable, and look at the loss of attachment. So even if here the pocket depth is very minimal, but look at the loss of attachment. Okay, and here look at the loss of attachment and look at the pocket depth. Pocket depth is very high, but loss of attachment nil. Okay, so this is why we conclude that loss of attachment is a better indicator of the disease activity. Here, in spite of a deep probing depth, the disease activity does not look that severe because there is no loss of attachment. And here, in this case, even though the probing depth is very minimum, almost 1 mm or let's say 2 mm, but look at the loss of attachment, that 1 or 2 mm probing depth is not denoting the actual disease. And that is why we conclude that loss of attachment is a better indicator or a reliable representative of disease activity. Okay. So this is all about probing depth and the associated terminologies in this session for now. I conclude my session here. Thank you, Axis Dental School and my co-judges and the moderator, madam, for giving this opportunity and this valuable time presentation set. Thank you once again.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for your excellent presentation.
May I ask a few questions to our honorable judge?
Yes.
May I ask?
Yes.
Okay, ma'am. It's been brilliant so far. So being a dental practitioner, actually, I'm rather than a clinician than the academician. So I will ask you regarding some clinical aspect. So how often in your practice you motivate your patient for periodontal treatment? Actually, in our country, our patients are not so aware of the periodontal condition. They just came to us with prompting the pain in the pulp or missing tooth. But whenever we want to put some pressure on the periodontal health, they are not cooperating us. So how you motivate your patient? Because I think periodontal treatment is a phase-wise treatment. You need to see the patient very frequently. So how do you motivate them?
See, I personally believe in motivation by demonstration.
Okay.
First thing is we demonstrate the various brushing techniques. We demonstrate them the mouthwashing technique and flossing technique. We make them aware of all the various oral hygiene aids, including manual as well as powered, including for the teeth as well as the interdental. Okay. First of all, they should be aware of all these aids. And second thing is the actual case scenarios. We can try documenting our cases. If we have those before and after, or even intra, the main part is intra actually. The patients have that surgery phobia. That's a very common phobia prevalent amongst patients when they hear the word surgery. So practically speaking, we avoid the term surgery. We don't use that term at all. Okay. We can, it's like treating a pediatric child, like, actually speaking. So you can mask the words, because surgery creates phobia in everybody's mind. If I see myself telling somebody, telling me, madam, you have to undergo surgery. Obviously, it's difficult to manage your or make up your mindset. Okay, so choosing some wise words instead of using our actual terminologies, using some case demonstrations in our clinic to show them that the patient has come with such preoperative scenario, he underwent so intraoperative procedures, and the postoperative came out to be a beautiful postoperative case. So this can also motivate the patient. If the patient is having a target of achieving that post-operative site, maybe he or she will take up a chance to undergo the procedure. These are the two main things, demonstration and case presentations.
Okay, do you document your all cases?
Not all cases, noteworthy cases where I can show the difference between pre and post. Because see, there are some cases where there is nothing preoperatively, but we know there is subgingival deposit. Even the OPG will show us, right? So in that case, the OPG should be documented, and those subgingival deposits which are available, which are visible as flakes, can be highlighted for the patient if the patient can understand your OPG. Okay. So there are two ways of documenting the case. If it is a full gingival inflammation case, preoperative clinical should work, and if it is a subgingival deposit case, even the OPG should be included. And if it is a regenerative case, an OPG is a must with the IOPA of that site particularly. But most commonly, the models work a lot. We have various periodontal models available to keep in our clinic to show them the various procedures, the patterns of bone loss, the patterns of the defects, and how do you fill the various materials available.
Okay, so, one more question. If moderator permit me to ask one more question.
Yes, sir.
Okay, madam, one more thing, that when you are going to perform a surgical periodontal therapy, so what kind of biomaterials you use in your practice?
See, usually we use xenografts if the patient does not have any objection with using an animal origin product, xenografts or last alloplasts. But I hardly doubt if any person will give consent for undergoing autograft second surgical site. If it is readily available, for example, there is a tori or a tuberosity, and the patient has to undergo the resection of that bony component, then autograft will work. Allograft, I doubt anybody gives consent for allograft, another human body component. Consent issues exist. So that is why the commonly used materials are xenografts and alloplasts, and the newer materials, which is Emdogain.
Emdogain available in your country? Is it available? Emdogain is available in India?
No. We have to procure it. We have to procure it from the foreign country. But yes, it is available. The procedure will be lengthy, but it's available.
You can have it if you want.
Yeah, clinically, we go for xenografts and alloplasts. Autografts, as I told, if there is a case which can be combined together, like an extraction socket, where we can take up some bone.
Okay. Thank you, madam. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, madam, I have some question. Number one, how you assure the patient that this case is successful? What types of gingival incision is more successful, more successful than and what type of pocket, that means what type of mobility is easily correctable.
I'm sorry, pocket?
And pocket, that means the pocket depth, the pocket depth, how much the periodontal pocket depth is usually curable case, pocket depth, how much the pocket depth is usually
curable? For surgical procedure.
Yeah, surgical procedure.
For that, we follow the critical probing depth rule given by Linde et al. Okay, that is more than 6 mm, rounded to more than 6 mm, it's indicated for a flap surgery. Now, it depends on the bone loss pattern. If it is a horizontal bone loss, regenerative is not possible there. So, we go for a flap surgery there, periodontal flap surgery. Now, again, it depends on the various factors, that is the transgingival probing depth, the tissue thickness. Okay, and that's how we decide our flap surgical technique, whether we will do a marginal incision or submarginal incision or directly clavicular incision if the tissue is unavailable, adequate tissue is unavailable. Okay, so 6 mm is the rule. More than 6 mm, we should go for flap surgery because it says the bristles usually reaches up to 3 mm, and that is why 3 mm is considered to be a sulcus, healthy sulcus, because bristles clean them up. Where bristles cannot reach, their disease is bound to happen. And so there we have to go for professional cleaning. The first rule is SRP. If the SRP gives the results, then surgery may not be indicated. That is why we have the pre-surgical phase, that is our etiotropic cause-related therapy first, phase one therapy. And then after that, the patient is kept on maintenance phase, wherein the patient is checked for the remaining residual pockets. If those residual pockets show up for more than 6 mm, then we have to schedule a surgery. But usually, while they are under maintenance phase, if they show the pocket depths are below 6 mm, they can go for another round of scaling and root planing and maintenance for lifelong. Okay, the maintenance is lifelong. Mm-hmm. Maintenance is not a temporary procedure. Maintenance means the patient has to come for follow-up every 6 months or 12 months as per the Marin's classification of supportive periodontal therapy. So 6 mm is the rule.
What type of incision is easily curable but easily successful? What type of decision? Miller classification, what type of decision?
For recession,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
We use Miller's, we use Mahajan's classification. It's given in the Journal of Indian Society of Periodontology. Mahajan's classification, because Miller's classification has its own set of drawbacks.
Yes.
Like it does not count mucogingival, it counts mucogingival junction, that is why it's not applicable on palatal aspects. So what about the recessions on the palatal aspects? Although they are not aesthetic concerns, but soft tissue support is required, right? For the overall health of the tooth. So for that sake, Mahajan's classification is then kept taken into consideration. But primarily Miller's classification.
Yeah, Mahajan classification, yeah.
Sir, in this regard, I have another question. Can I? So, very frequently we see a recessed patient in our practice. So, we correct gingival recession by various type of graft or flap in the facial aspect, but actually we don't do it in the lingual aspect or the palatal aspect. I have never seen that. So, can you explain why?
Basically, gingival recession, if you have attended my videos, I have an entire playlist of periodontal plastic and aesthetic surgery.
Yes, surgery.
Recession comes under aesthetic concern, yes. So, if it is aesthetic concern, the procedures are taken up. But there are many other case scenarios where palatal or lingual recessions needs to be treated. One of the most common scenario is implants. When we place implants, the soft tissue has a great difficulty getting at the level of the implant neck, right? The collar. So very common case scenario found associated with implants is recession. That can be palatal, that can be facial. But wherever it is, it needs to be treated.
to get that overall strength of the, or provide that overall strength to the implant. Okay, so it's the soft tissue support is for the overall health of the tooth or the implant, whatever present in the mouth. That is why we take into consideration palatal aspects. But for aesthetic concerns, it is mainly facial and labial. Okay.
Yes, it's in the labial.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you
so much, ma'am, for your excellent presentation and your excellent information. And I think our presenters and viewers have cleared all of your all of their confusion about this topic. And we have learned a lot from your presentation. And also thanks to Dr. Anupam Padar sir, Dr. Ansaruddin Ahmed sir, because we have learned a lot by asking your questions. And those amazing questions will help us for our further studies and for our further life, and it's a really very blessing for us. And we also thank you again, because we are very grateful to you taking time of your busy schedules to join with us. And it's very much a learning session today held. And now I would like to mention the time that have taken our participants to complete their presentation. And I think it will be helpful for our judges to judge our participants. And the time was for Bibi Khadija Anushapu, 5 minutes, 2 seconds. And Fariha Tabassumapu, it was 8 minutes, 1 second. And our final participant, Fariha Chaudhuri Riditapu, it was 9 minutes and 11 seconds. And ladies and gentlemen, I hope you all enjoyed this session a lot, because we have such an amazing judges like Dr. Ankita Kekotecha ma'am, who is a gold medalist. And I'm really blessed that I have speaking with ma'ams and the Dr. Anupam Padar sir, Dr. Ansaruddin sir. It's really very very enjoyable, and it's really very memorable for me for my lifetime. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. I also thank that our president, Access Dental School's president, Farhad Bhaiya, for giving me this opportunity. And once again, I want to thank our participants for their brilliant participation and for their brilliant presentation. It's really an amazing, and it's really very inspiring for our further students. And now I would like to invite all of you for our next episode, which will be held at 7 September at 10:30 p.m. And the participants are Maisha Shaherlat, Musharrat Muntaha Shamsi, and Shatil Kar. And now we are ending the program of this session. And now I'm seeking the permission of our judges to end the program.
Yes, okay. You can now ending the session. I'm very much thankful to Dr. Ankita Kotesa for your nice and informative presentation. I'm very much grateful to you. I hope you will always with us. I'm again invite you for our any session for any. I would like to invite you in our session that is convened by Dhaka Dental College Kisses Association or Bangladesh Post-Dentic Society. Any type of program, you will come, you with us, and I hope your presence is gain our knowledge, and also our participant, our student will be very much helpful to your session. Thank you.
So, dear viewers, I would like to enjoy the next episode of our paper presentation competition. Till then, stay safe, stay blessed, wear masks, and stay always tuned with Access Dental School. Assalamualaikum.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Namaskar. See you again. Thank you, Ansar. Bhalo theko.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Assalamualaikum. Markula amra diye dio. Ankita ma'am, please give mark in my messenger, and Ansar also.
Okay. I will send it.
Thank you. Thank you, Fariha. Thank you, Dui Fariha. Thank you, Khadija.
Thank you so much, sir. Ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you all.
Okay.
Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu
alaikum. Namaskar, ma'am. Namaskar, sir.